Since Barack Obama became president, he has charged 10 more people with espionage, none of whom have been accused of giving information to a foreign government. This is all for contact with journalists. That's more than three times all previous presidents combined. It's Nixonian, is what it is. The only hope that we have, because God knows Congress doesn't have the balls to change this. They haven't in the last 109 years. They're not going to change it now, or 100 and whatever, 99 years. The only hope we have is twofold. The only way that you can appeal an espionage conviction is if you go to trial and are convicted of espionage. There are only two people who fit that. That's Chelsea Manning and Jeffrey Sterling. And Jeffrey Sterling is just down the road here in, what's it called, Englewood, I think, FCI Englewood. Daniel Ellsberg, who's the godfather of all whistleblowers, is leading a fundraising campaign to raise enough money to pay for Chelsea Manning's attorneys so that she can appeal the Espionage Act convictions. It's a long road, and I'm not sure that even the Supreme Court has the stomach to do it. With that, I'm going to keep my fingers crossed, but with that, I went way over. I'm looking at the clock here, but let's do some Q&As. I'm very happy to take your questions. Again, thank you for having me. It's really my pleasure to be not just in Colorado, but right here in the room with you today. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, Cheryl, I just want to say a word as treasurer of Fort Collins Community Action Network. I thought I had. That STP is a part of that umbrella organization. And the turnout today tells me that there are lots of people very concerned and very interested and probably very well informed about some of the things that are being talked about. If you want these kind of events to continue to happen, then you do need to support financially Strength Through Peace and its umbrella organization, Fort Collins Community Action Network. Every year, we're needing to find more new sponsors for our organization to replace some that leave or for whatever reason leave the area. So please consider, if not giving generously today, consider also being an ongoing sponsor, a sustainer, and you can do that by giving us your bank account number and we'll make it really easy to take money out of your bank account for such things. You know, good things. Let us get into your bank account for good things. No, but that will help us sustain the work not only of Strength Through Peace to bring you these events, but the other ongoing, very important work that we do in this community on the behalf of poor people, on the behalf of those who need our support and for progressive change here. So thanks for letting me give that spiel.
Thank you, and if you could keep your questions brief, we'd appreciate that.
What do you think that a movie like Zero Dark Thirty, all about torture, I mean, what do you think that does to like the national perception that people have about the CIA's torture program?
Yeah, great question. When Zero Dark Thirty came out, I had no intention whatsoever of seeing it, and Daniel Ellsberg called me, and he said, you have to see this movie, and you have to write a review, because you're the only one with the moral authority to do it. It was like 2 days before I left for prison, so I didn't see it until I got home. God knows they didn't show us Zero Dark Thirty in prison. I have two thoughts about that. Number one, the film itself, I think, did the American public a great disservice, because it perpetuated this lie that torture was what led to the killing of Osama bin Laden. It was just simply a lie. Really great analysis is what led to the killing of Osama bin Laden. So I think that Mark Bull and Catherine Bigelow really went the wrong way on that issue. I have a friend who is very close to Mark Bull, and I'm told that he regrets being involved in this thing at all. I'm glad to hear that. Now, the other point I want to raise on this, and this is where the CIA goes over the top, the CIA actively collaborates with Hollywood writers and producers. And indeed, we know, thanks to the Freedom of Information Act, that when Mark Bull and Catherine Bigelow approached the CIA about making the movie, they were given classified briefings, They were given access to a classified mock-up of the bin Laden compound. And we also have learned recently that they gave their CIA interlocutors gifts like watches and tickets to the premiere that are illegal. Now, remember what I said the definition of espionage was? Providing classified information, providing national defense information to any person not entitled to receive it? Where are the charges for Leon Panetta? Because that's exactly what he did. And then in the victory lap after the movie was made, he said in a speech in the CIA's auditorium, where Mark Bull was present and other people who did not have security clearances, Panetta revealed the name of the SEAL Team 6 officer who shot bin Laden. Okay? That is a violation of the Intelligence Identities Protection Act of 1981. And I wrote an op-ed that ran in the LA Times saying, there's an empty bunk in my cell, and Leon Panetta is perfectly welcome to come and have it. But there were no charges for Panetta. You know, when you're a pal of the president, or you have four shiny stars on your shoulder, or you're identified in the New York Times as the president's favorite general, there are no espionage charges for you. So the whole episode was just a terrible disservice to the American people.
I'm just curious. I'm sure you've heard the recent statements of Donald Trump criticizing Ted Cruz for not being hard enough upon the position of waterboarding.
Right.
So, I'm not convinced that the American public is ever going to come around, but of all the presidential candidates that we have, do you have any hope that any of them might end up addressing the situation, what you've described, mm-hmm. this endemic?
A little bit. I have a weekly newspaper column that runs in small town papers, and I wrote a column last week saying, never in my life, and I've been a political animal all my life, but never in my life have I ever seen so many presidential candidates tell us in advance that they're going to commit an impeachable act. Right? Who does that? Who gets up there and says, I am going to commit a war crime as soon as I'm elected? And then Carly Fiorina says, I will too. And then Cruz says, well, I will too. And Rubio said, well, I'm not sure. Okay, I will too. It sickens me that public opinion polls show that a majority of Americans support torture. It sickens me. And that's one of the things that makes me feel like I really need to stay out there talking about this. Right, the media does say it's okay, but finally yesterday, and I saw this on Facebook of all places, a former senior CIA officer said, it doesn't matter who's elected president, nobody is going to get back into the torture business. Now, the CIA has lied to us about everything since September 11th anyway, but and I want to believe that he's telling us the truth, but I think it's up to us to do a couple of things to make sure that no matter who's elected president, we don't return to a torture regime. We need to ride our members of Congress. Ride them. You know, we've got these oversight committees, the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence and the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence. They're supposed to be oversight bodies, not cheerleaders. But when you have a new chairman, Senator Richard Burr, a Republican of North Carolina, for example, say on his first day as chairman that on his watch there will be no investigations of the CIA, that's not oversight. I mean, I understand Frank Church is dead. I understand that Pat Moynihan is dead. But by God, there has to be somebody on Capitol Hill with the guts to stand up to the CIA and say, you work for the American people, and we are the representatives of the American people, and we are going to oversee your operations. And that hasn't happened yet. Now, in terms of people, serious candidates with a potential to win, who I would trust, certainly Bernie Sanders, who I just absolutely adore. And I'll tell you a Bernie story in a second. And as crazy as it sounds, Rand Paul. I mean, Rand Paul doesn't mind polling at 2%. But he can't win a Republican primary. Bernie Sanders. When I worked for John Kerry on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee staff, I would go down to the Senate cafeteria every morning and get a bagel. And every single morning, there was Bernie sitting at a table, having breakfast, and inviting any Joe who walked in off the street to sit and have breakfast with him, and the only thing he insisted on was that you call him Bernie. Mm-hmm. And then there were idiots like, you know, Ben Cardin, the junior senator from Maryland, who would say, I'm a senator coming through, I'm going to the front of the line, I'm a senator, and I saw him actually shove a pregnant woman out of his way so he could go to the front of the cashier's line. Bernie's not like that. So go Bernie.
In Cheryl's introduction, she mentioned that you were sort of recruited by a CIA spotter who was one of your professors.
Yes.
And so I kind of had sort of basically to the, was curious, to the sort of to the extent of your knowledge, how prevalent are these CIA spotters in academia, and how sort of how common is it that they're recruiting sort of young students, and how does
yeah.
this relate to this idea you were talking about recruiting people with sociopathic tendencies?
It's actually illegal now. The way I was recruited has been illegal since the passage of the Equal Employment Opportunity Act in 1993. Bill Clinton saw to that. But there are still CIA officers on most campuses, at least most major campuses around the country. They have this thing called the Officer in Residence Program. So it's a pre-retirement job for people who have done their 30 years and want to go back home. So let's say, you know, you were born and raised in Bloomington, you want the Indiana University job, or you were born and raised in LA, you want the USC job. And then you're going to teach a couple classes about the CIA or intelligence, or in one case, a friend of mine has one of these positions and is teaching a course on espionage in Soviet literature, which he's apparently an expert on. So those CIA officers, while there are many of them, are overt, and they're there as adjunct or visiting professors. Separately, the CIA Office of Recruitment goes to colleges and universities constantly and recruits, just like they've done since the 50s. It's much less romantic today. You generally just have to go to www.cia.gov and click Apply Now. That's it. Yeah. This is Mr. Arne Menconi, who is the Green Party's candidate for United States Senate for the state of Colorado. I'm very proud to know him.
Well, thank you. I've had the pleasure to know John over the last year, and I'm honored that I was able to drive down from Carbondale with my two children and have my children meet a national hero.
Oh, no.
I've been to his house in Arlington, and I want to ask a favor. I've met Jessalyn through John. I've met Tom Drake through Tom. And I spent 10 days with Daniel Ellsberg and wrote a book with him, Daniel Ellsberg, and gotten to know the whistleblowers. These people have gone way beyond our imagination and sacrifice. And John and Jeffrey Sterling should be pardoned by the President of the United States. And if the people who are watching this on television, the people in this room, could take some of the sacrifice out of your time and ask your representatives and president to overturn the conviction that John Kiriaqou has outlined in this conversation. This is insane.
Thank you.
And they need to, our people need to hear this. Tonight there's, my question, John, is tonight there's a Republican debate.
Mm-hmm.
It seems as though the only foreign policy that's discussed in either the Democratic or the Republican debate is counterterrorism.
Mm-hmm.
You're a counterterrorism specialist. Can you speak to why this has become the monologue of our foreign policy in the United States?
Yeah, people are easily frightened in our country. And, you know, we've really transitioned to a permanent wartime economy with the September 11th attacks. And I don't mean to sound conspiratorial because it's not my nature to be a conspiracy theorist, but I really believe that the large corporations in this country can thrive only in this permanent wartime economy. And so we need to identify an enemy to have at all times, an enemy that we can build up against. And that's why almost none of the presidential candidates, with the exception of Bernie Sanders, are talking about actually downsizing the military. That's the first point. My second point, I think, would be that another part of our problem is there really aren't many differences between the two major parties. I mean, they're basically the same. You can tinker around the edges of some of these issues, but look at it this way, especially on national defense and national security issues. In 2002, George W. Bush was documented as having killed one person with the use of a drone, okay? Barack Obama killed 424 people with drones in October. So really, what's the difference between the Bush foreign policy and the Obama foreign policy? I would say that the Obama foreign policy is nothing more than a more violent extension of the Bush foreign policy. That's the problem we have in our presidential candidates not wanting to talk about anything but terrorism. And one final point, now that it's popped into my mind. Again, I've gone nose-to-nose with Al-Qaeda, nose-to-nose. Another group, another well-known terrorist group, tried to kill me in the Middle East. There were two assassination attempts against me. So I feel like I know firsthand about terrorism. And I can tell you that the solution to the terrorist problem is a long-term one. And it's one of education and public works projects. Because if these guys that I mentioned in these isolated villages in their home countries could read and write and had job skills and had clean water and maybe a hospital nearby or roads to get to a job, we wouldn't have this terrorism problem. We wouldn't have to deal with it. It's as simple as that. But it's long term, and it's not sexy like an F-35 and a special stealth, you know, drone with extra missiles, and it's hard to sell. People don't want to talk about it.
Sir. I was wondering if you're allowed to disclose the information about the other, basically the torture stuff that you know, the other 10 things. I was wondering
to
disclose those.
Yeah, they're all in the public record now.
Okay.
And they're listed in the torture report in their entirety. But they're everything from, the basic one was an open-handed belly slap, right? Because it makes a loud cracking sound and it's humiliating and it leaves a red mark. That's supposed to be the first thing that they do to you. And then they can smack you across the face. And again, in the Senate torture report, it specifically said that the middle finger can't extend beyond the earlobe, the palm can't extend beyond the back half of the chin. It's all very specific. And then it goes to walling. And then there was the confinement box, which was either a large dog cage or a small dog cage. Sometimes, especially in the case of Abu Zubaydah, they would put him in a dog cage and then put the dog cage in a cardboard box so it was dark, and he had this irrational fear of cockroaches, and they would dump cockroaches into the box with him, right? And then it progressed its way up to waterboarding, to the cold cell, and one I didn't mention that I should have, which really is one of the really heinous ones, and that's sleep deprivation. Donald Rumsfeld famously said in whenever it was, 2007, I guess, that he was deprived of sleep all the time. He would work 36 hours, 48, 72 hours with no sleep, and he had a stand-up desk at his office. He wasn't even sitting down when he was working. But the kind of sleep deprivation we're talking about is you're chained to that eye bolt in the ceiling again with hard rock music blasting in on you 24 hours a day, those military-grade halogen lights bearing down on you so you can't sleep, and they keep you up, according to the Senate torture report, for a period not to exceed 16 days. Okay, we know that people begin losing their minds at day 9, and people begin to die at day 12. And the goal is to keep you awake for 16 days? If you're lucky, you live, but you can't participate in your own defense because by then you've lost your mind. And others have died. And again, nobody was prosecuted.
What do you think of the NSA's prodigal child of Edward Snowden? Like, you know, he did come forth and then, well, now he's in Russia, so. Mm-hmm.
I think Ed Snowden's a national hero. I really do. I take a lot of crap for that in a lot of venues, but I think he's done the country a great national service. I might not have released everything that he released. I actually want us to be intercepting Angela Merkel's cell phone. That's what NSA does. That's what we want them to do. Whether it's to give us a leg up in trade negotiations or to disrupt terrorist attacks, we want to be targeting foreign nationals. So I may not have, you know, said that, but all in all, we wouldn't know that NSA is spying on us if it weren't for Ed Snowden. And this nonsense that is spouted by Hillary Clinton and John Kerry, that he defected to Russia and he needs to man up like they've ever been men. He needs to man up and come and face the music. I've written to him privately through, we share some attorneys, and I told him, don't come home, because in the Eastern District of Virginia, you'll never get a fair trial, never. And there's one judge in particular. She was my judge. She was Jeffrey Sterling's judge. She assigned the case of Ed Snowden to herself. Nobody's ever won with this judge. And I warned him that what the Justice Department might attempt to do is they'll say, and he wants to come home, but they'll say, all right, you do 5 years or you do 10 years. And the judge will say, I don't accept this plea. Throw it out. And she gives him 40 years or 30 years, because that's what's going to happen. So I think he did a great national service. Now, this silliness about him running to Russia, defecting to Russia, he was in the transit lounge at Moscow Airport on his way first to Iceland and then to Latin America when Hillary Clinton revoked his passport. And he was stuck in that transit lounge for 3 weeks, if you recall. The only reason he's in Russia is because Hillary Clinton put him there. She stuck him there. He had no intention of remaining in Russia. And another thing, too, and this became an issue in my case, there's a Latin term in the legal profession called mens rea. It means guilty mind. Criminal intent is what it comes down to. One of the reasons why I was absolutely convinced I was going to win my case is because I had no criminal intent. I'm a patriot, for God's sake. You know, I've always said that the Republican Party and the conservative movement in this country do not have a monopoly on patriotism. So I was confident, I'm going to win this thing. And on my very first day, in my very first hearing, the judge said, I will not respect Judge Bennett of the Southern District of Maryland's decision on mens rea. And my attorney said, Your Honor, are you saying that a person can accidentally commit espionage? And she said, that's exactly what I'm saying. And my attorneys said, this is going to be a problem. And it was. You know, same thing with Jeffrey Sterling. There was no, literally no evidence that Jeffrey Sterling committed a crime. But his jury in the Eastern District of Virginia found him guilty of 9 felonies, including 7 counts of espionage, for having a conversation with James Risen of the New York Times. You know, you just don't have a chance. Not when criminal intent is not a factor. Sir.
My question is, if you hear a confidential security information and you pass it on, are you become liable too?
If you are a private citizen?
Yes.
No. That's a great question. That's a very important point.
Good, because I was afraid that...
no. And similarly, if you are a working journalist, you are not liable for prosecution unless you are making a conscious attempt to gather classified information for the purpose of distributing it. That's why journalists generally aren't prosecuted. Now, the last attorney general we had, Eric Holder, described a Fox News journalist, James Rosen, as an unindicted co-conspirator. I'd call that a war on the press. You know, when instead of being a journalist doing his job, he's an unindicted co-conspirator, you know that there's a problem with this administration. And these guys are supposed to be the progressives. Just imagine if Ted Cruz is the president, what's going to happen.
John, thank you very much for your talk.
My pleasure.
It was excellent. There were a few criticisms I had of it, and one I think you attributed to someone else, which was, I just want my country back from 9/10.
Right.
And
actually, I want my country back from 1975 from the Church Commission.
Well, I'll go back a little further. And actually, you can go back, you know, to the very foundation of the country. But in 1964, the CIA came out with a publication called Kubark Counterintelligence
Yes.
Interrogation, I believe.
Yes, in fact, somebody tried to send it to me in prison, and the warden rejected it as being disruptive.
Strength Through Peace did a little research into this at the time of the Abu Ghraib scandal mm-hmm. to, you know, explain that torture actually went back kind
Yes.
of a long ways from the CIA.
Yes.
And the thing that struck me of Kubark is that the point was to make people feel that they were damaging themselves. So yes. The stress, you put people in stress positions, and they were causing themselves the mm-hmm. pain,
yes.
and so they blamed themselves.
Right. It's called it's called learned or acquired helplessness.
You know much more about it than me, I'm sure. But so could you comment on how does what was going on in Kubark mm-hmm. Compare to what happened after 9/11/01? Are we in a qualitatively worse era, and how so? That's my question.
After 9/11, it became more more regimented and more formal, and it was better documented. The CIA, this has been a cyclical issue for the CIA over the years. The CIA did some terrible, terrible things in the 1950s and 60s. For example, the prices of which we're still paying today. I mean, the overthrow of Mossadegh in Iran, we're still dealing with the ramifications of that terrible operation. Look at the trouble that the CIA has caused in Latin America over the years, Guatemala, El Salvador, Nicaragua, the Dominican Republic. We're still feeling that the after effects of those operations. So we've go through these periods where torture is okay, and then torture is not okay again. Probably the golden age for civil libertarians was in the immediate aftermath of the Church Committee hearings, where there really was oversight. In fact, in the aftermath of Church, Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan of New York wrote a book, a very well-received, critically acclaimed book, saying there's no need for a CIA anymore. Certainly the Directorate of Operations can be folded into the Department's Defense Human Services. They do human source collection. And the analytic arm of the CIA, the Directorate of Intelligence, can be folded into the State Department's Bureau of Intelligence and Research. And then the Directorate of Science and Technology can be split between the Pentagon and NASA. There's no need to have a CIA anymore. You know, John Kennedy played with that idea and took two bullets to the head. And I'm not saying that the CIA killed Kennedy. I'm just saying at the time of the Kennedy assassination, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. When I joined the CIA, before I joined the CIA, I went to a classmate of mine in grad school, and I knew that her boyfriend was at the CIA. And I asked if I could have dinner with him. So we got together. And I said, listen, I was just talking to this guy. He's pitching me for the CIA. But I have some concerns about the bad old days, and I want to hear your side of the story. And he said, oh, yeah, that's all in the past. Since the Church Committee, it's been great. We don't do any of that stuff anymore. I said, all right. And then, honestly, everything seemed to me to be okay. I was a junior analyst, so I really didn't have a full view of what was happening. But then when Bill Clinton was elected, the CIA went through this this culling of sources. Anybody who had any history of human rights abuses was fired from the payroll, right? And they got rid of something like a third of their sources. And I thought, you know, this is great. This is exactly the way it should be. We shouldn't have people on the payroll who are torturers, you know, generals with human rights issues in their past, et cetera. And that worked until September 11th. And then all the rules went out the window. And everything, no matter how crazy it sounded, was appropriate if you could make an argument that it somehow made Americans safer. And we've never come back from that. It's become the norm, which is really dangerous.
I read your letters from prison on the Common Dreams website.
Terrific.
And the question that kept coming to my mind was, I wondered if your identity was known widely or at all to the fellow prisoners, because sometimes accounts that come out of prison are that there's punishment, and then there's the brutality that is visited on somebody who is labeled or tagged as a traitor to the country, mm-hmm. causing American boys to be killed, mm-hmm. et cetera, et cetera. So I wondered how that worked.
Thank you for that question. I love talking about this. Everybody in the prison knew who I was before I arrived. Several hundred prisoners get the New York Times. I was on the front page of the Sunday Times the week before I arrived in prison, so everybody knew. So several things happened, virtually all in my first week. When I turn myself in. Well, I should back up. At sentencing, the judge ordered that I be sent to a minimum security work camp, Club Fed, as they misidentify it in the press. And, you know, Club Fed, there's no fence, there are no walls, you can work in town, you just have to be on your honor to, you know, come back on time. And so I got to prison my first day, and I went over to the camp, and I said, "Hi, I'm John Kiriaqou, I'm here to turn myself in." The guy says, "Everybody has to check in across the street at the prison." I said, "Okay." My attorneys, I went up to prison with Jesslyn Radack, Tom Drake, Jim Spione, who directed and produced the documentary film Silenced, my cousin and his son-in-law. So we took this big van up there. They dropped me off, hugs, kisses, goodbye. They drove away. I go across the street to the prison. I said, "Hi, I'm John Kiriaqou, here to turn myself in." The guy looks at his computer. He says, "Okay." He said, "Turn around, put your hands behind your back." I put my hands behind my back. He cuffs me. Then he shackles my ankles. And he said, "Okay, let's go." And I said, "Well, wait a minute. I'm supposed to be at the camp across the street." And he said, "Not according to my paperwork, you're not." So I thought, oh my God, they're putting me in the actual prison. Take it easy. There's nothing you can do. If you make a scene, they'll put you in solitary. It was 5 days before I was allowed to make a phone call. So I called my attorneys and I said, "Listen, they put me in the actual prison, which was a low security prison, but which means double walls, concertina wire, controlled moves, the whole nine yards. Murderers, mostly pedophiles, but lots of murderers too." And he said, "Well, we can file a motion, but it'll be 2 years before we get a hearing. You're just going to have to tough it out." So I was in prison. Well, the only thing that the guard told me as I was checking in was, "Hey, buddy," he said, "one of the most important rules is if somebody comes into your cell uninvited, that's an act of aggression." And I thought, great, I'm 50 years old. I'm going to have to defend my, I'm going to get my ass kicked on the very first day in prison. So I'm sitting on the edge of my bed, and these two Aryans walk into my room, just walk right in. Big swastikas on their necks. One guy had tattooed F-U, so every time he blinked, yeah. How do you like that in a job interview after he gets out of prison? So I jumped off the bed and I said, "What do you want?" And one of them says, "Take it easy." He says, "Are you a fag?" And I said, "No." And he said, "Are you a rat?" And I said, "No, I'm not a rat. I didn't have anybody in my case." "Are you a chomo?" I said, "I don't know what that means." He says, "Chomo," like I'm stupid. "Child molester." I said, "No, I'm not a child molester." So he said, "Okay, you can sit at our table in the cafeteria." And I thought, oh, I guess I'm with the Aryans now. So a few days later, these two big, muscle-bound black guys come into my cell. And same thing, I jumped up. I said, "What do you want?" One guy puts his hands up. He said, "Are you the CIA guy?" I said, "Yeah." And he's holding this newspaper. And he said, "Reverend Farrakhan says you're a hero of the Muslim people. And we wanted to tell you that you're not going to have any trouble with us." And I said, "Okay, thanks." I said, "Thanks, I appreciate it." And he says, "I don't shake hands with the white devil." I said, "I'm sorry." I said, "Thank you. I appreciate you coming in." And then finally, I was across the hall from a senior captain in the Bonanno crime family. And when I was done with my New York Times, I would give them to him, and he would give me his New York Post. So we kind of struck up this friendship, to the point where he said to me one day, "Yeah, I'm in on a murder charge. Somebody found a body in a barrel in my on my storage unit." He said, I don't know how that body got in there. Like 100 people had access to my storage unit." I said, "Pete, you don't have to explain your case to me. I don't care how the body got in your storage unit." Anyway, he said to me one day, "Let me ask you a question. Why do you sit with those retards in the cafeteria?" I said, "I don't know. They invited me my first day here." And he says, "From today, you're with the Italians." So I said, "Thank you." We had the actual boss of the Gambino crime family, Little Nicky Carozzo. We had Peter the Rabbit Calabrese. We had the boss of the Calvacante family. We had the Genovese family's captain who ran the port of Newark. And I was friends with all these guys. There was one thing, though. little Nicky, he's doing 18 years on 18 murders. How he must have had a brilliant lawyer. I don't know. But anyway. Yeah. So I stayed away from Nicky because he had a reputation as being obviously very violent. And then one day one of his bodyguards came up to my room and huge guy, like stupid, cross-eyed, and he says, "The boss wants to see you." And I thought, oh my God. Because I've been trying like not to make eye contact with the guy. Everybody else was great to me. I go down to his room and I said, "Mr. Carozzo, did you want to see me?" And he says, "You the CIA guy?" I said, "I am." "You write a book?" I said, "I did." "Your book do good?" I said, "Actually, it did very well. I made number 5 on the New York Times bestseller list, and it was my first book." He goes, "You're going to write my book." I said, "Oh, is that what this is about?" And he says, "I'm going to tell you stories, and you're going to write them down." I said, "Well, let's think about this for a second. You know, most of the books of this genre are written by rats. And they spend the first half of the book talking about all the cool things they did. But they spend the second half of the book trying to justify why they turned rat. And you're not a rat, and you probably shouldn't talk about all the cool stuff you've done. I wouldn't write the book." And he says, "Hadn't thought of that. Never mind." But then from that day, I was invited to every Italian dinner, every Italian party, birthday parties, going away parties. They had a crooked cop on the payroll. We had pork loins and lamb chops and white wine for the marsala sauce and fresh mushrooms and tomatoes and Alfredo. I gained 15 pounds in prison. I did. 15 pounds. The cops would come in, "What are you guys cooking today?" "Oh, we got some nice veal chops here." "Wow, it really smells good." "Yeah, it does." So the Italians took care of me. And there was one Italian in particular who really became my closest friend. I actually miss his friendship very much. We're not allowed to have contact because that would be consorting with known felons, which means I would go directly back to prison. So he had read about my case in advance and took it upon himself to engage with every one of the Italians at Loreto to explain to them the difference between the CIA and the FBI, right? The FBI are rats and cops. The CIA are heroes who protect the country overseas. And so as soon as these Italians understood that I didn't have arrest powers and I never ratted on anybody, I was one of them. And it made life very, very, very easy. I'm writing a book about this. I finished it, actually. It's out for bid. It's called Doing Time Like a Spy, How the CIA Taught Me to Survive and Thrive in Prison. And there's one account of, I was near the end of my sentence, and my bunkmate was the former mayor of Cleveland, right? Awesome guy, totally corrupt, just like a big brother to me. He was so great. So he said to me one day, "Hey, John, there was some guy in the insulin line tonight talking trash about you. He said you were a rat." I said, "Who? Who said I was a rat?" Those are fighting words. And he said, "I don't know. I never saw him before." And then, sure enough, another friend of mine from Texas came down and said, "There's this guy in the cafeteria telling people you're a rat." I said, "Point him out to me. I want to see who this guy is." And they pointed him out to me in the cafeteria, and I shouted at him. I said, "Hey, you have a problem with me?" And the guy says, "You know what I said. You know where I live. You come up to my room and we'll finish this between the two of us." I said, "Right now," I told him. "Well, the only place where the cops feel vulnerable is in the cafeteria because you have 1,400 guys and 10 cops, right? So they're always worried about violence breaking out." And I stood up. I said, "Let's go right now." I had no intention, really. I was bluffing. So one of the Aryans came over and he said, "Please, please, not in here. They'll arrest all of us and put us all in solitary." Well, Peter the Rabbit Calabrese was next to me. And he looks up, he says, "What are you doing?" "Sit down," he says. "We'll take care of this later." So I'm staring at this guy. And I said, "As God is my witness, Pete, I'm going to kill this guy." And I don't know why I was so angry. Nobody had ever called me a rat before. But this guy maintained that I had ratted out the CIA by talking about torture. So I sat down, and then Pete says, we're going to go back to my room, and you're going to read the USA Today. So I was shaking. I was so angry. We went back to his room. He hands me the USA Today. He says, I'll be back in a minute. So he and another Italian went out, and they came back 20 minutes later, and he said to me, it's all taken care of. I said, what's that supposed to mean? He said, it means don't worry about it. It's all taken care of. I said, all right, all right. I said, I trust you. I gave him back his paper, and I went to my cell. About 20 minutes later, the guy comes down to my room, and his face is like this. And there's blood coming out of his nose and blood coming out of his lip. And he says to me, I'm very sorry for calling you a rat. I don't know why I did it. I'll never say it again. I said, get out of my room before I kill you. And he went back to his room, and there was never any problem again after that, because I had the Italians to rely on.
I read some time ago that former President Truman wrote a letter to the Washington Post in, I think, 1963, that his greatest mistake was signing the CIA Act.
I've read that.
And the Washington Post, as I understand, printed it in their first edition and then pulled it from the later one.
Yes. Yeah, interestingly enough, J. Edgar Hoover was the one that put it into Truman's ear that this creation of the CIA was a terrible, terrible mistake. Now, Hoover was saying that for his own purposes, of course, because when Congress first began considering the National Security Act of 1947, Hoover just assumed that the CIA was going to be a division within the FBI. And when General Donovan insisted to Truman, and Donovan had Truman's ear, when he insisted to Truman that the CIA be an independent standalone agency, Hoover turned and tried to talk the president into first not signing the bill and then later to disbanding the CIA in the next National Security Authorization Act. It didn't work, and we've been stuck with the CIA ever since.
I have a two-part question. So the first part of my question, I agree that ethics should be introduced back into politics and other areas as well besides just intelligence operations. Mm-hmm. But I was curious if you've ever thought about the steps that need to be taken to introduce ethics into intelligence operations. And then the second part of my question, and forgive my ignorance on opinion and your position, but do you think the torture program needs to be completely eradicated, or like, do you think there is some good that comes out of it and it just needs to be reorganized?
I'll answer the second part first, because that's an easy one. No, I think torture is inappropriate under all circumstances. There's no place for it. It doesn't work. It's not moral. It's not ethical. It's not legal. We have this Federal Torture Act that bans it. We're signatories to the United Nations Convention Against Torture. And indeed, not only were we the original signatories, we were actually the authors of the United Nations Convention Against Torture. And let me add another thing to that. January of 1968, the Washington Post ran a front page picture of an American soldier waterboarding a North Vietnamese prisoner. When the Secretary of Defense, Robert McNamara, saw that picture, he ordered an investigation. And the soldier was arrested, and he was tried and convicted of torture, and he was imprisoned. Well, the law hasn't changed since 1968. So why was torture illegal in 1968, but not illegal in 2002 or in 2015, you know, when we had to pass the McCain-Feinstein Amendment to reaffirm our national ban on torture? So the law never changed. American politics changed. We need to change it back. In terms of how we implement ethics into our political system, I think there are two ways to do it. One is Congress has very, very strict ethics regulations, and both houses of Congress have an ethics committee that is not only to advise the members of Congress on ethics, but every staff member on Capitol Hill. I can't tell you how many times I had to engage the ethics committee on sometimes very basic questions, but that's what they're there for. If there's any question at all, you just ask the ethics people what to do, and they tell you what's the right thing, what's the wrong thing. So I think that needs to extend to the executive branch. I think every federal department and agency, like they have a general counsel and they have an inspector general, ought to have a chief ethics officer. Justice does, although the Bush administration bastardized the position. But I think every governmental agency should have a chief ethics officer. Another thing is that lots of colleges and universities across the country, especially Catholic schools, have very robust ethics programs, ethics departments in many cases. And I think we need to rely on those people to guide us in government as to what proper ethical processes are, not just in intelligence operations, but in any governmental function at all. You know, they're experts in ethics, and we should rely on that expertise.
John, thank you so much for your presentation.
Thank you.
Because
my pleasure.
This has been very, very helpful. And this is the kind of thing I think that we need much more of, rather than the circus that's going on right now with the presidential candidates.
Agreed.
But I wanted to ask you, if you had a magic wand and you could really revise the whole approach in this area of foreign affairs, what would you do? What would be your suggestions?
Affairs writ large?
Well, and CIA and the interaction between those. This is just a short question.
Yes.
Sorry.
You know, I'm so arrogant that I've never been stumped before. I'm stumped now. In a perfect world, the setup that we have ought to work. It's not a perfect world. And for the most part, I think I blame Congress. Congress just over the decades, I mean, through generations, Congress doesn't lead. They're reactive, reactionary. There's really no oversight. And it's both parties. And they lie. You know, when I was in college, I used to be an autograph hound. And my college roommate and I would each buy copies of the Almanac of American Politics. We didn't have Friday classes, so every Friday we would go up to Capitol Hill and we would get autographs from famous senators and congressmen, right? And I have, you know, some of the giants, Barry Goldwater, Ted Kennedy, Bob Dole, Scoop Jackson, Mo Udall. It was loads of fun. And I thought these guys were special because the country had entrusted them with leading us. And, you know, now I realize how naive and how childish that was, that for the most part, they're idiots. They're just idiots. And they're opportunists on top of it. So when you have the likes of Dianne Feinstein, you know, just cheering for the CIA and approving of the torture program, and then when things hit the fan, saying, well, geez, I don't think I was briefed on that. And they say, well, yeah, you were. Maybe a staff member forgot to give me the notes. No, you were there, and we have a record of you being there. Yeah, I just don't remember. Well, that's not leadership. That's not oversight. You know, when Dianne Feinstein says, I don't know if I like Leon Panetta as director. We need somebody who really knows intelligence. So I'll vote for Panetta only if Steve Kappas gets to be the deputy director. Well, Steve Kappas was one of the architects of the torture program. So thanks to Dianne Feinstein, we have this, you know, had this continuing legacy of torture. Another problem is all the senior CIA leaders of the Bush administration were the senior CIA leaders of the Obama administration. They're civil servants. They didn't go anywhere. And they know that they can outwait presidents. Presidents are going to be there for 4 years or 8 years. These guys are going to be there for 35 years. So they can just wait. So really, I think that the problem that we have had is a problem of congressional leadership. You know, the CIA, just by its nature, is going to try to get away with as much as it possibly can. But that's what oversight is all about. Oversight is a committee saying, wait a minute, no, you can't do that. You can't overthrow that government. You can't establish that secret prison. Another problem is when the CIA determines that an operation is so sensitive or so classified, it only informs the chairman and vice chairman of the two committees, right? That's considered to be notification. But if the chairman and vice chairman of the committees are true believers and cheerleaders, then again, there is no oversight. So it's all about Congress, in my view. Well, thank you very much. What a pleasure it is to be here. I really appreciate it. Thanks for everything. Thank you.
So I also wanted to let you know that it's going to be broadcast on Fort Collins Public Media. So thanks to Philip Mayer for videotaping it for us. And when that comes out on Fort Collins Public Media, I'll let you know via social media and our listserv so you can tune in and let your friends know.